Tonight's headlines are brought to you in part by Coldwell Energy and McDonald's.
Good evening, Commonwealth, and thanks for watching the Channel 2 News. I'm Sally Lemus. Let's take a look at tonight's top stories. The CNMI is beginning to see back-to-back deaths related to COVID-19. Also tonight, the Omicron strain affects the island's tourism. And infrastructure upgrades heading this way soon. In sports, a new team dominates the Christmas Island Relay. Stay with us. These stories and more are next.
Holy night, Merry Christmas. Friends are knocking on the door. Happy faces, warm embraces, all that we adore. Christmas night, we're together. No more time for feeling blue, 'cause it's our little Christmas and our dreams are coming true. Happy time, Merry Christmas. Friends are knocking on the door. Smiling faces, warm embraces, all the things that we adore. Christmas night, we're together. No more time for feeling blue, 'cause it's our Merry Christmas and our dreams are coming.
Green sea turtles and hawksbill turtles call the Mariana Islands home. They're an important part of the marine ecosystem. They are under threat, and they are protected under CNMI law. Keep plastic out of the ocean. Keep vehicles off the beach. Use the sea turtle stranding hotline if you see poaching activities or if you see a turtle in trouble. Call 287-8537 and save a turtle.
And there you have it, McDonald's new crispy chicken sandwich. From the makers of the world's most stolen fries. The juicy chicken sandwich from the place that offers extra napkins for a reason. The tender chicken sandwich from the creators of a sandwich phenomenon. So you won't just be biting into a chicken sandwich, you'll be biting into McDonald's new crispy, juicy, tender chicken sandwich. Ba-da-ba-ba-ba.
Half a day to the Wami and good evening, Commonwealth. Today is Monday, December 27, 2021. Health officials report 4 COVID-related fatalities since the weekend and are currently preparing for the numbers of positive cases to increase, especially after this holiday season.
This morning, we've had our 12 COVID-19-related deaths since March 2020.
The Commonwealth Healthcare Corporation reported 2 COVID-related deaths on Saturday, 1 on Sunday, and another this morning. To respect the privacy of the families, no further details were given. CHCC identified 156 positive cases of COVID since Friday night. There are currently 14 hospitalizations with 2 individuals on a ventilator. Given all the gatherings taking place this holiday season, officials are preparing the healthcare system for another surge.
Under the direction of the CEO and the task force, there's been an expansion of testing that you're aware of at the DFEM sites, increased testing internally using PCR-based. So we are getting ready for an increased surge. There's also examination of all excess beds available here at the hospital and the alternate care society. However, the hope is that as increasing number of people get vaccinated, we will be able to temper any surge from a new variant.
Dr. Ali Khan is the medical epidemiologist from the World Health Organization and has been here for about a week now. He applauds the community's response to the pandemic.
I must say, what I've seen is a model public health response focused on science, the community working together, and there's great evidence of that, not just in the vaccination numbers, but as I've roam the streets and see all these stores and indoor places, everybody wearing masks. So it's really been an excellent response so far. However, as the CEO said, at the end of this pandemic, and not the end of COVID, COVID isn't going to go anywhere, but the end of the pandemic where it's disrupting your lives and it's, you know, putting too many people into the hospital and keeping the economy from thriving is vaccinations.
Currently, the CNMI has a 93.4 fully vaccinated population. Hospital Chief Esther Munya says the numbers are good, but continues to ask those who haven't gotten their shot to reconsider.
I cannot emphasize enough how important it is, especially as this community, again, continues to suffer with deaths as well as with increased hospitalizations. And of course, you know, with our healthcare system, with our healthcare providers working night and day, just to make sure that individuals have the treatment and trying as much as possible to help them recover from this pandemic.
COVID therapeutics are available to patients in the CNMI. These were given emergency use authorization by the FDA. Rodelin Bacani, who is the pharmacy manager for CHCC, states there are different types of therapeutics for patients with COVID and post-COVID exposure. Patients who refuse to receive treatment are kept under careful monitoring to make sure symptoms do not progress any further.
Most of them are in quarantine, so they are not just, you know, let go. They're being monitored, or they were monitored closely. Of course, if their symptom would progress to mild and moderate to severe, then they will get something else. Because we have the remdesivir and the tocilizumab also that we are currently giving for admitted patients.
Yeah, I guess there's a difference between in an outpatient service.
Yeah.
You know, you have the option to refuse. Of course, any patient it has the option to refuse treatment. But you know what we are trying to offer, what we're trying to offer in the outpatient setting, is really to try to prevent hospitalization
and
death. So that's the purpose of the treatment.
The Marianas Visitors Authority Board met this morning in Sasupi. Omicron has put a winter chill on a January that was supposed to be about recovery and now appears to be anything but. Our Chris Nelson reports.
Masaru Sunaga of PMT was sworn in today as a new board member for MVA. Sunaga takes the place of Masato Tezuka, who retired and moved back to Japan. Main order of business today, the Korean tourism market. January forecast for Korean travelers is extremely low, as new fears of Omicron have put a chill into travel demand.
And airlines and travel agencies are saying that with this number, which is they saw the load factor really looked like a less than 20% per flight.
That is Sejin Kim talking from MVA's Korea office. CNMI currently the only place Koreans can travel to in the world without having to quarantine on the way back into Korea. That was negotiated as part of the travel bubble last summer when Governor Torres traveled to Korea with MVA officials. The bubble should give the CNMI a leg up on other destinations, and MVA brought in media, funded airline incentives, subsidized hotels, gave financial incentives to travel agents and travel bucks to tourists. Three airlines currently have flights scheduled into Saipan. November load factors were high, but December saw a number of cancellations as fears over Omicron surfaced, and those fears appear to be continuing into the new year. For health reasons, the airlines are limited to a load factor of 70%, a number imposed by the Korean government.
Initially, will be ended January 6th. We're actually expecting it's going to be extended, the 70% load factor limitations, but we don't know yet. So we don't know how long it's going to be, but we still not sure about it, really.
MVA's Korea office is recommending that MVA use ARPA funds to continue to subsidize airlines in the upcoming months, starting with January. The board needs to decide whether to spend money to incentivize reluctant travelers or save the money and use it when things become more clear.
If we use everything up, just because we're trying to maintain or, you know, to fund some people coming here, you know, through these really, really slow months, it's just, I think it's more important that we look at the restart of the tourism program.
We definitely have to figure out at what percentage of load factor is the best way to provide incentives to the airlines, because travel boxes are already excluded.
No final decision made today. The board is scheduled to resume its meeting on Thursday. Chris Nelson for the Channel 2 News.
Something we can look forward to in the upcoming new year: funding opportunities from President Joe Biden's Infrastructure Act. CNMI senior officials make their way to three states to secure the Commonwealth's share of the pie.
Finance Secretary David Attalick, Chief Information Officer Clifford O'Don, and Chief of Staff Will Kostru represented the CNMI in the National Governors Association Infrastructure Summit. The three-day event was held in Annapolis, Maryland earlier this month. Implementation of the Bipartisan Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act was the main topic of discussion. Chief of Staff Will Kostru states their trip in the mainland extended further to Washington, D.C. and Hawaii.
But started out in Annapolis, Maryland at the National Governors Association Infrastructure Summit. And then we went on to Washington, D.C. To meet with a senior advisor at the White House and then with Insular Affairs. And we rounded off the trip with a stopover in Hawaii to meet with a very successful not-for-profit partner with AmeriCorps and then our Guam partners as well before coming back to Saipan.
The $1.2 trillion legislation provides investments in roads, public transit, rural broadband, airports, water and wastewater systems, and other capital projects across America. The Commonwealth is expected to receive more than $170 million for these projects. Of course, to start these projects, the Commonwealth will need manpower, and lots of it.
Thanks to the private sector representative, Mr. Sablan, he was able to bring it up to the president, senior advisor issues relative to foreign labor and easing some of the restrictions that we have here in the Commonwealth, because the amount of projects and money that's going to be invested in infrastructure is going to require a significant amount of people in the workforce. Unfortunately, at this point in time, we don't have the numbers. And so I was very, very pleased with Mr. Sablan leading that discussion relative to contract workers and foreign workers. And not just raising the issue about why it's problematic, but also being proactive in suggesting to the White House representative on how to ease that, perhaps by increasing manpower at the closest embassy to facilitate the process.
Finance Secretary David Attalick says the Commonwealth can also expect an upgrade on broadband services.
We're coming up with a good amount of funding that we can improve our internet, our communication, add more towers to our islands, on all three islands, including the Northern Islands, so that as we have more boaters going around, communication will be easier, help save lives, and have these so-called dead spots be activated so that communications for any future emergency issues are addressed.
The Commonwealth will also be receiving funding for roads, highways, and shipping.
And that's the big item, is getting designated a maritime highway designation so that we can get funding also to subsidize or to help out our shipping costs between the islands. And that way, hopefully, we can help our neighboring islands of Tinian and Rota get better shipping opportunities of goods at a lower cost so that we can bring down consumer good pricing down. And not only them, but also we're working with Gov Guam to try to work on an MOU between Guam and CNMI or Saipan, so that goods transported between our two islands can have reduced cost. And that way the end result is our consumer will save money and get, you know, fresher and products quicker.
The money for the Infrastructure Act won't come in all at once like the previous federal assistance. The funding will come as needed.
Different sections have different tranches of funding availability, depending on the need. And so it's supposed to be spread out over five years. And, if we're going to do a project, a large project like the airport has, 20 some million dollars for improvements, we don't expect that all to be done in 1 year. So they'll distribute those funds as needed. It is kind of budgeted for a 5-year period, but there's opportunities, like I shared, that we can get those funds sooner than later should the need arise.
Governor Torres states this is an historic event in the Marianas that will create jobs, modernize government, better connect the people, and build a more resilient infrastructure for the future generations.
Coming up, we bring you to Santiago. Stay tuned.
As we face a great global adversary, even in this season of giving, let our homes be filled with laughter, happiness, and hope. Though we celebrate from a distance, may our hearts be filled with faith, joy, and love for one another. Let us count our blessings and look towards the future and celebrate what we accomplish together. Just as the Star of Bethlehem guided the three wise men to the birthplace of Jesus, so too would the love of our family and friends and our collective faith, prayers, and hope lead us to a better and brighter tomorrow. Only together we will prevail. Please continue to wear a mask, wash your hands, and watch your distance. Stay safe, Marianas.
Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
To all you KSPN2 viewers, it is officially our favorite season of the year. Now, I know celebrations won't be the same, especially during this pandemic, but knowing us, I know we'll make something out of it. Now, from the bottom of our hearts here at KSPN2, we want to wish all of you guys a very, very Merry Christmas. Welcome back to the Channel 2 News. Tonight, we head into a cathedral that has been around 1,000 years with 2,000-year-old remains. Our Chris Nelson reports from the Trail to Santiago and his ultimate goal, a sunset on the edge of Spain.
The courtyard of the Cathedral de Santiago Compostela is full of people. Some have been walking for weeks, others for days, and some come directly just to see the church that was built 900 years ago around the reputed final resting place of St. James the Great, one of the apostles of Jesus Christ. Inside the cathedral, students gather to play and sing during a special mass.
Thank you.
one more thing, and it's 50 miles away, the Cape of Finisterre. In Roman times, this was believed to be the end of the world, and tradition is to come here after Santiago and bathe in the Atlantic Ocean. Many pilgrims sleep for a night on this beach. After watching sunrise after sunrise across the vast interior of Spain, it's finally time for a proper sunset, and the Camino delivers. For me, it's been 37 days and 1,000 kilometers over mountains, through forests, along coastline, rivers, and the meseta. The landscapes will leave a lasting imprint, but perhaps more importantly, so will the people, those who came to walk and those who welcomed us along the way.
I wish there was nothing left to say. We're lost, of course, in a verbal maze. Send your voice off to sleep. Let the silence take a leap. We find a way. We said nothing for a day.
The sign says 0 kilometers, the end of the road, the end of the world. It really feels like just the beginning. Chris Nelson for the Channel 2 News.
All right, thank you so much, Chris. Over on Guam, the Agriculture Department is securing federal funds for terrestrial invasive species and animals. KUAM reports.
Half a day seeing my Guahusi Isaiah again, and here's what's making news on Guam. The Guam Department of Agriculture is providing details on how they plan to reserve Guam's coral reefs through funding provided by the U.S. Department of Interior. KOM's Tyler Matsunani has this story.
The U.S. Department of Interior's Office of Insular Affairs is now taking applications for their Coral Reef and Natural Resources Initiative grants for FY 2022. The Guam Department of Agriculture has applied for the federal funding in the past, which addressed aquatic invasive species and plants. The funding is now expanded to terrestrial invasive species and animals. DOAG Director Chelsea Munia-Brett.
What we have considered and want to use this funding opportunity for is to apply for or use projects that will address stray feral dogs, but also feral pigs, which have become a danger and nuisance in our communities and our jungles and our conservation areas.
Mayors have expressed concerns over the growing number of feral pigs and the damage they cause through attacking agricultural areas and farms. The overgrowth is also causing an imbalance in Guam's coral ecosystems.
It's both deer and pigs, but specifically the pigs will eat and uproot new tree growth and plants that whose roots hold together the soil. So because we've had such an overgrowth of feral pigs and deer, which are called together as a group ungulates, they're eating all of these new tree growth and new plants and whatever fruit-bearing plants and trees are also growing in the jungle. So now there's less trees holding the soil together. So every time we have a heavy rain, all of that soil is washed into the rivers and then out into the ocean. So those are those big mud plumes that you see in the water.
The mud plumes block sunlight from the live coral, causing soil and sediment to settle on top, eventually suffocating and killing the reefs. She describes DOAG's plan to control the pig population.
I want to work with USDA to identify the kinds of Roundup pens that they're using and then apply for funding to purchase several of those work with mayors and set these up in the jungle.
Government agencies, education institutions, and nonprofit organizations whose grant proposals directly benefit the U.S. territories of American Samoa, Guam, the Commonwealth of the Northern Mariana Islands, and the U.S. Virgin Islands, as well as the Freely Associated States, the Federated States of Micronesia, the Republic of the Marshall Islands, and the Republic of Palau may apply for the grant funding.
Collaboratively, we all have our individual conservation restoration projects for conservation areas, but we also have collaborative projects that we work together on, too. So we're kind of attacking it from the same problem from different angles, but doing very similar work.
Munya Brett acknowledged the Leon Guerrero administration, who she says have pushed DOAG to find solutions to resolve the issue. Interested applicants can visit grants.org for more information. The deadline for submission is April 1, 2022. Reporting for Guam's News Network, I'm Tyler Matanani.
Inform 24/7 by checking out KUM.com or by downloading the KUM News app on your mobile device. Reporting for Guam's News Network, Guahusia Isaiah Ugin.
Thank you, Isaiah. All right, folks, do not go anywhere because we have sports up next.
You are everything that matters to me, and I promise to do whatever it takes to keep you healthy, to be comfortable, and to be free. I love you. As long as we're together, I'll always make sure that home will always be our best place to breathe.
Ready to quit tobacco? Call the St. Amai Tobacco Quit Line at 670-323-7848. Visit your dental clinic for a free oral health screening.
One of the best gifts you can give yourself is a healthy diet. At Gold's, our pre- and post-workout formula is loaded into every smoothie, giving you a satisfying meal with fewer calories, perfect to enhance a workout or replace a meal. In December, try our smoothie of the month for just $5.50. It's got great stuff in it like soy milk, bananas, spinach, chocolate, and mint. 302 calories, 23 grams of protein, and 7 grams of fat. Fast food that's good for you and tastes great. Shake it up at Gold's Gym, Garapan.
Tonight's sports brought to you in part by Tan Holdings through the Tan Soo Lim Foundation, making communities a better place to live.
Buenas sports fans.
For your KSPN2 Sports Report, a new running club joins the annual running event.
Run Saipan, a new nonprofit running organization, joins the annual Christmas Island Relay for the first time. Although Team Baby Got Track ruled this year's annual island relay, two teams from Run Saipan Club secured the second and third spots in this year's race.
Run Saipan, eh?
Angel Nicolas, Rex Pixley, Tiana Cabrera, Leowell Cristobal, and Keith Catola of Run Saipan A won second place. Run Saipan B finished third. This is the group of their president, Edward De La Cruz, Sildri Valora, Tanya Tan, Raylan Sapong, and Chong Nam Lee. Edward De La Cruz is very pleased with their team's performance in this event.
It was great. I think everybody had fun today. And it's really a great momentous experience for Run Saipan because it's the first time as a running an official running organization, Saipan, to take part in the annual Christmas Island Relay. We were initially supposed to have a total of 5 teams, but because of injuries and COVID, we got dropped down to like 3.
De La Cruz, an avid runner himself, is very happy to finally do an actual face-to-face race again.
I am just really happy because the last time we had a face-to-face one was, I believe, September. And then after that, we just kept doing virtuals because of the COVID. So I'm really thankful for Coach Sapong and Northern Mass Athletics to still be able to pull this with COVID-19 protocol mitigations. So I'm really happy. All the runners really happy. A lot of runners were contacting me the past month. Is the island relay going to be canceled? Is it going to stop? And I was like, no, NMA is going to go strong. And as you can see, everybody's happy here that we had an in-person race.
Run Saipan will host the last running race of the year, called Fastest 1 Mile Road Race, that is set to be on December 31st.
So the Island Relay was a team event for 1 mile. Now Run Saipan is going to host the fastest 1 mile on December 31st for an individual solo event. So if you're not happy with your time, you have December 31st to challenge everybody else on Beach Road.
Meanwhile, Run Saipan 2, the third team from the same organization, finished 10th overall. The team members are Rosemary Chisato, Ann Bang, Arvin Velasco, Jessica Ortizo, and Evelyn Pegalinan.
Thanks.
Buy one, get one free for the off-road adventure at Marianas Trekking. Come ride our side-by-sides at our best price ever and experience a great 90-minute trail ride. Rain or shine, hopefully rain. Book now at Marianas Trekking. Saturdays and Sundays by reservation. Call 323-8735 or book at marianastrekking.com.
Hi, I'm Dre, one of the personal trainers here at Gold's Gym, and today we're going to show you a Bulgarian split squat, a fantastic lower body exercise that should be a main staple in your training. Now, the first thing we want to address is the rear foot placement. Now, whether it's toes on or toes off, just find what's comfortable for you. The bigger issue we want to tackle is the height of the box or bench. You see, when you set up on a box or a bench that's too high, that inherently puts an aggressive stretch on the front of your hip. Oftentimes, that sensation will take away from the working leg, the leg that's on the floor. And when you start to add load in this faulty position, you're bound to run into some problems, particularly if you got some mobility restrictions. So Jamila's gonna set up. She's gonna descend with control, and from there, just stand tall.
Alright, your weather report is today mostly sunny with isolated showers, east-northeast wind around 18 miles per hour, high 86, low 76, a 70% humidity. Tomorrow, expect partly cloudy with isolated showers, breezy with an east-northeast wind 21 to 25 miles per hour, high 86, low 76, a high rip current risk remains in effect. Wind waves 3 to 4 feet, east swell 5 to 7 feet. Now the sunrise will be at 6:41 a.m., high tide 1:58 p.m., low tide 8:47 p.m., and yes, you can catch the sunset at 5:55 p.m. All right, folks, there you have it. That is your Monday edition of the News, Sports, and Weather. We thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you back here on Wednesday.